selling people's at Stapleton, the craziest, I know what time it is. Wild Wild West, now born, Killer Hill, brought to the Richmond, Jungle Nails, let's get money, y'all. It be the sass of Hennessy that make me act like this. I'm where I hit them up, projects now never play the fifth. Regardless, to the charges, chicken had to be at court, fighting and slicing each other to see who lies in my fort. Who would've thought? Little Shy, Big Willie, 96, we rolling Dutchess, not Trey, it was Phillies. First in the month, we like Christmas, the dealers. $100 sales come through the school zone area. Children that play, keep the heat on the low. Little kids getting hit, project flooded with bone. Now shorty's rocking for size. She and Donna Karen playing the Miss Marv Queen role, knowing her and her cousin Sherry. I live the glamorous life, girl. The goat, the limo, the dawn, carry on. Rich hotel, rich hotel. Queensbridge connection. Five boroughs. Roll town. Incarcerated, activated, trapped behind the cell with no way to escape it, holding on to the ox still, try to appeal, remanded without a bail, so let the commissary bill. I feel it's time for me to let the sparkling wine wet my throat, rocking the trench coat, flashing to get my now as the tick, cause the ante keeps me bent, just trying to make a cent, digging pockets down to the lid, regardless of all the charges the D's want me for, warrant after warrant, so I avoid the law. Stapleton on the rise, 27 where it lies. So they want till they none, don't take it as no surprise. How we do it, y'all? Kill a game, where you at? Red Bud, Big Gil, Bogey. What up, y'all? Represent, y'all. Represent. Suicide thoughts, cause I'm screwed up in the game. But today's aim is to hold it down and maintain. I got 30 days until I get remanded for this gun charge. Still I'm living large, joint hard up in the morning, Lord. Sexing, this your repeat model. I'm young, black, rich and dangerous. Living like I'm on the lotto. So enough for wine, sets and dutches. Them kids know who us is. GP Woo, under 27 hustlers. Running from D's when they try to bust us. Find grills and gas, mainly black cops, they whitey lovers. And my district attorneys wanna send me to jail. I told them people wanna kill me, that's why I had the 9 million. I busted dead not to injure. Remember when I quote before you into my center. Word up. The lost generation. Work out. 49. 27 click. Will do small.
You govern a kingdom by normal rules. You fight a war by exceptional moves. But you win the world by letting alone. How do I know this is so? By what is within me. The more taboos and inhibitions there are in the world, the poorer the people become. The sharper the weapons the people possess, the greater confusion reigns in the realm. The more clever and crafty the men, the oftener strange things happen. The more articulate the laws and ordinances, the more robbers and thieves arise. Therefore, the sage says, I do not make any fuss, and the people transform themselves. I love quietude, and the people settle down in their regular grooves. I do not engage myself in anything, and the people grow rich. I have no desires, and the people return to simplicity. That is a quote from chapter 57 of the Tao Te Ching. Welcome, you are listening to River West Radio. I'm your host, Cassius King, and I am the producer of this show. The things you will hear over the next hour represent the views and opinions of this particular show and the people making them. All opinions and quotations in no way represent River West Radio and are the sole responsibility of the producer, me. Guests and callers as well. River West Radio is not liable for any legal issues arising from the content of this program. So, sue me, not the radio.
Soon come and come to me, Rasta. I'm not moving from Messi, you know. I've had him in a low.
Why? Show me love, it's illegal, demo. When I get in demo, oh man, don't go from head to toe. Up close and personal, get enough attention. Y'all and you all, man, what we know. Me love, it's illegal, demo. When I get in demo, oh man, don't go from head to toe. Up close and personal, get enough attention. Y'all and you all, man, what we know. No kid, then no man, you me deal. All that a vandal no deal. Some all want fi sample, all ready fi trample. None of them out, they don't care. All them want do a wear and tear you. People want so much, them come near you. But you know easy fi get a knife, you bust up your bed. Tell them that somebody they don't want it. So put your love is illegal them, when everything them. Oh man, don't go from head to toe. Up close and personal, get enough attention. Oh man, are you all man want fi know. Me love is illegal them, when everything them. Oh man, no good from head to toe. Up close and personal, get enough attention. Oh man, are you on my mafia? For the shape where you have to get a triple A plus. Man, I can be fast, I'll pulse in a rush. To all these calamushes and steal money enough. All man, I observe, look, 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 push. Have a body most woman do that diva. Pretty girl, man, I cry, I water. With your stress, I'll pass, if like later. Whenever you pass it, I call me over. To me, look, it's illegal, demo. When everything demo. Oh man, no good from head to toe. Tender up and junction up close personal. Wild and go down and go low. Me love is illegal demo. When everything demo. Oh man, no good from head to toe. Tender up and junction. Oh man, you a kill man. Wild and go down low. Taking a walk along the broadwalk. So many girls and all of them sharp. Ladies who are the number one fan your chat. Only one look at me world is that. Stay well and sharp if it no play. Spooky and short, she no long like giraffe. And anything touch your body just a bounce off. Pay no attention to careless talk. Me love is illegal them, when everything them. And them no good from head to toe. Come front and personal. Umwella, umwella, umbuji bata na fi make the world know. Me love is illegal them, when everything them. Woman no good from head to toe. Come close and personal. Love no attention. Won't find off your flow. Hey, no be some no man yeah, me deal. A whole lot of bandas out there. Some will run for sample. Only one chump. None of them out there don't care. All them want do a wear and tear you. You go bust so much them come near you. But you know easy to get on. You bust off your bed. Tell them that somebody they know about it. I put your love is illegal them. When everything them. Oh man no good from head to toe. Up close and personal. Get enough attention. Tell her you on man what we know. Me love is illegal them. When everything demo, oh man, no good from head to toe. Up close and personal, hear the men sang. And I want the world know. Finish here for you, have you get a triple A plus. Man, I'll tap it fast, I'll proceed in a rush. To all this girl, I'm she can see money enough. All man, I observe, look, 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 look. Have a body most, woman, do that taiva. Pretty girl, man, I'll have you water. We'll stress all parts, if like later. Whenever she pass it, I call me over. So me love is illegal demo. When everything demo, oh man, no good from head to toe. Up close and personal, get enough attention. Wine and gun, no, no, no. Me no physical legal demo. When everything demo, oh man, no good from head to toe. Center of attraction, up close personal. Oh man, are you on my mind?
Continuing from our reading of manufacturing consent. K. Continuing from our reading of Manufacturing Consent, The Political Economy of the Mass Media by Edward S. Herman and Noam Chomsky. We had last left off with the description of how the growing expense of running a newspaper company in the early 20th century and late 19th century made it increasingly difficult for individual communities or small movements to put their word out, essentially. While the stock of the great majority of large media firms is traded on the securities market, approximately two-thirds of these companies are either closely held or still controlled by members of the originating family who retain large blocks of stock. The situation is changing as family ownership becomes diffused among larger numbers of heirs, and the market opportunities for selling media properties continues to improve. But the persistence of family control is evident in the data shown in Table 1-2. Also evident in the table is the enormous wealth possessed by the controlling families of the top media firms. For 7 of the 24, the market value of the media properties owned by the controlling families in the mid-1980s exceeded $1 billion, and the median value was close to $500 million. These control groups obviously have a special stake in the status quo by virtue of their wealth and their strategic position in one of the great institutions of society, and they exercise the power of this strategic position if only by establishing the general aims of the company and choosing its top management. The control groups of the media giants are also brought into close relationships with the mainstream of the corporate community through boards of directors and social links. In the case of NBC and the Group W television and cable systems, their respective parents, GE and Westinghouse, are themselves mainstream corporate giants, with boards of directors that are dominated by corporate and banking executives. Many of the other large media firms have boards made up predominantly of insiders, a general characteristic of relatively small and owner-dominated companies. The larger the firm and the more widely distributed the stock, the larger the number of and proportion of outside directors. The composition of the outside directors of the media giants is very similar to that of large non-media corporations. Table 1-3 shows that active corporate executives and bankers together account for a little over half the total of the outside directors of 10 media giants, and the lawyers and corporate banker retirees, who account for 9 of the 13 under retired, push the corporate total to about two-thirds of the outside director aggregate. These 95 outside directors had directorship in addition to 36 banks and 255 other companies, aside from the media company and their own firm of primary affiliation. In addition to these board linkages, the large media companies all do business with commercial and investment bankers, obtaining lines of credit and loans, and receiving advice and service in selling stock and bond issues, and in dealing with acquisition opportunities and takeover threats. Banks and other institutional investors are also large owners of media stock. In the early 1980s, such institutions held 44% of the stock of publicly owned newspapers and 35% of the stock of publicly owned broadcasting companies. These investors are also frequently among the largest stockholders of individual companies. For example, in 1980-81, the Capital Group, an investment company system, held 7.1% of the stock of ABC, 6.6% of Knight Ridder, 6% of Time Incorporated, and 2.8% of Westinghouse. These holdings individually and collectively do not convey control, but these large investors can make themselves heard, and their actions can affect the welfare of the companies and their managers. If the managers fail to pursue actions that favor shareholder returns, institutional investors will be inclined to sell the stock, depressing its price, or to listen sympathetically to outside contemplating takeovers. These investors are a force helping press media companies toward strictly market profitability objectives. So is the diversification and geographic spread of the great media companies. Many of them have diversified out of particular media fields into others that seemed like growth areas. Many older newspaper-based media companies, fearful of the power of television and its effect on advertising revenue, moved as rapidly as they could into broadcasting and cable TV. Time Incorporated also made a major diversification move into cable TV, which now accounts for more than half of its profits. Only a small minority of the 24 largest media giants remain in a single media sector. The large media companies have also diversified beyond the media field, and non-media companies have established a strong presence in the mass media. The most important cases of the latter are GE owning RCA, which owns the NBC network, and Westinghouse, which owns major television broadcasting stations, a cable network, and a radio station network. GE and Westinghouse are both huge, diversified, multinational companies, heavily involved in the controversial areas of weapons production and nuclear power. It may be recalled that from 1965 to 1967, an attempt by International Telephone and Telegraph, ITT, to acquire ABC was frustrated following a huge outcry that focused on the dangers of allowing a great multinational corporation with extensive foreign investments and business activities to control a major media outlet. The fear was that ITT control could compromise the independence of ABC's news coverage of political events in countries where ITT had interests. The soundness of the decision disallowing the acquisition seemed to have been vindicated by the later revelation of ITT's political bribery and involvement in attempts to overthrow the government of Chile. RCA and Westinghouse, however, had been permitted to control media companies long before the ITT case. Although some of the objections applied to ITT would seem to apply to them as well. GE is a more powerful company than ITT, with an extensive international reach, deeply involved in the nuclear power business, and far more important than ITT in the arms industry. It is a highly centralized and quite secretive organization, but one with a vast stake in political decisions. GE has contributed to the funding of the American Enterprise Institute, a right-wing think tank that supports intellectuals who will get the business message across. With the acquisition of ABC, GE would be in a far better position to assure that sound views are given proper attention. The lack of outcry over its takeover of RCA and NBC resulted in part from the fact that RCA controlled over NBC had already breached the gate of separateness, but it also reflected the more pro-business laissez-faire environment of the Reagan era. The non-media interests of most of the media giants are not large, and excluding the GE and Westinghouse systems, they account for only a small fraction of their total revenue. Their multinational outreach, however, is more significant. The television networks, television syndicators, major news magazines, and motion picture studios all do extensive business abroad, and they derive a substantial fraction of their revenues from foreign sales and the operation of foreign affiliates. Reader's Digest is printed in 17 languages and is available in over 160 countries. The Murdoch Empire was originally based in Australia, and the controlling parent company is still an Australian corporation. Its expansion in the United States is funded by profits from Australian and British affiliates. Another structural relationship of importance is the media company's dependence on and ties with government. The radio TV companies and networks all require government licenses and franchises, and are thus potentially subject to government control or harassment. This technical legal dependency has been used as a club to discipline the media, and media policies that stray too often from an establishment orientation could activate this threat. The media protect themselves from this contingency by lobbying and other political expenditures, the cultivation of political relationships, and care in policy. The political ties of the media have been impressive. Table 1-3 shows the 15 of 95 or outside directors of 10 of the media giants are former government officials, and Peter Dreyer gives a similar proportion in his study of large newspapers. In television, the revolving door flow of personnel between regulators and the regulated firms was massive during the years when the oligopolistic structure of the media and networks was being established. The great media also depend on the government for more general policy support. All business firms are interested in business taxes, interest rates, labor policies, and enforcement and non-enforcement of the antitrust laws. GE and Westinghouse depend on the government to subsidize their nuclear power and military research and development, and to create a favorable climate for their overseas sales. The Reader's Digest, Time, Newsweek, and movie and television syndication sellers also depend on diplomatic support for their rights to penetrate foreign cultures with U.S. commercial and value messages and interpretations of current affairs. The media giants, advertising agencies, and great multinational corporations have a joint and close interest in a favorable climate of investment in the Third World, and their interconnections and relationships with the government in these policies are symbiotic. In sum, the dominant media firms are quite large businesses. They are controlled by very wealthy people, or by managers who are subject to sharp constraints by owners and other market profit-oriented forces. And they are closely interlocked and have important common interests with other major corporations, banks, and government. This is the first powerful filter that will affect news choices. Tune in next week for a continuation of Chapter 1 from Manufacturing Consent, The Political Economy of the Mass Media by Edward S. Herman and Noam Chomsky, published by Pantheon Books.
Lucifer, son of the morning, I'm gonna chase you out of earth. I'm gonna put on an eye.
iron shirt and chase the devil out of earth. I'm gonna send him to outer space, find another race. I'm gonna send him to outer space, find another race. Gonna iron shirt and chase Satan out of earth. I'm gonna iron shirt and chase the devil out of earth.
We'll be right back.
This week's on Cook's Corners, we'll be looking into a recipe called Ode to Chang Kung from the Moosewood Cookbook by Molly Katzen. Chang Kung is the Chinese kitchen god who watches over your stove when you bring out your wok. This recipe will require 3 cups raw flat egg noodles cooked in salt water and then drained, 3 stalks fresh broccoli thinly sliced, 1 large sliced onion, 1/2 tablespoon sliced fresh mushrooms, 1 pound fresh mung bean sprouts, 1/2 cup each sliced water chestnuts and bamboo shoots, 1/2 pound tofu, soybean curd, cut into small chunks, about 3 cakes. 2 tablespoons sesame oil, 3 tablespoons safflower oil, 1/4 cup sherry, 1/4 cup tamari, 1/2 teaspoon freshly grated ginger, or more to taste, and 1/2 teaspoon of dry mustard. Optional ingredients are minced garlic sautéed, black mushrooms softened in boiling water, sliced and sautéed, and extra vegetables. With your ingredients, sauté onions, broccoli, ginger, and mushrooms in safflower oil until tender. Add remaining ingredients, toss to mix and heat thoroughly. Top with toasted sesames and cashews, chopped scallions and green peppers. And you have your ode to Chang Kung. Serves approximately 6, takes about 1/2 hour to prepare, if you can chop vegetables in 1/2 second. A reading from Wen Su, Understanding the Mysteries, Further Teachings of Lao Tzu, translated by Thomas Cleary, published by Shambhala. Lao Tzu said, "Yin and Yang mold myriad beings. All of them are born of one energy. When the hearts of those above and those below are estranged, then energy evaporates. When rulers and ministers are not in harmony, the 5 grains do not ripen. Coldness in spring, blossoming in autumn, thunder in winter, and frost in summer are all products of destructive energy. The space between heaven and earth is the body of one being. All within the universe is the form of one being. Therefore, those who understand their essential nature cannot be threatened by heaven and earth. Those who understand correspondence cannot be confused by strange things. Sages know the remote by way of the near, considering myriad miles one and the same. When energy evaporates in heaven and earth, then courtesy, justice, modesty, and conscience are not established, and all the people transgress upon each other. Violence and cruelty are still there in the midst of indistinct vagueness. When modesty and conscience decline, eventually society degenerates. Then there are many demands and few goods. People work hard without being able to make a sufficient living. The populace is poor and miserable. So anger and contention arise. This is why humaneness is valued. People are debased and unequal. Cliques and factions each push for their own interests. Hearts full of machinations and cunning deceptions. This is why justice is valued. Men and women mix indiscriminately. This is why courtesy is valued. The sense of essence and life is unruly, inharmonious when pressed by necessity. This is why music is valued. So humaneness, justice, courtesy, and music are means of remedying decadence. They are not the way to comprehensive government. If you can truly employ spiritual illumination to settle the land so that the mind returns to its origin, then the nature of the people will be good. When the nature of the people is good, then yin and yang of heaven and earth accord with it and unfold it. Then there are enough goods and people are adequately supplied. Greedy, mean, angry, and contentious attitudes cannot arise in them. Humaneness and justice are not employed, but the way and its virtue settle the land, and the people do not indulge in ostentation. So it is only after virtue declines that people dress up in humaneness and justice. It is only after harmony is lost that people embellish music. It is only after social behavior becomes dissolute that people adorn their appearances. Therefore, it is only after you know the virtue of the way that you know humaneness and justice are not worth practicing. And it is only after you know humaneness and justice that you know rites and music are not worth cultivating.
Drop on a mission for the frequencies, speakers, lights, mics, wig, technical, and level speed.
Continuing from our reading of The Selma of the North by Patrick D. Jones, The Civil Rights Insurgency in Milwaukee. Reading from the chapter, Father Grappi's Civil Rights Awakening. For the first time, we came into contact with and directly experienced discrimination and racism. We took care of children in the mornings, and then we called on families in the evenings. That whole experience brought about a conversion experience, you could say, or a change of will in all of us, where we became very committed to social justice around the issue of race. From that point forward, Grappi's reaction to racism and discrimination was immediate, emotional and personal, not abstract or intellectual. For him, the face of a young African-American girl, stung by a racial slur, held the pain of Jesus Christ as he hung on the cross. It was the pain of rejected love. James Grappi completed his work at the seminary in 1959 and was ordained as a Catholic priest. Although he requested an assignment in Milwaukee's inner core, the Archdiocese sent him to St. Veronica, a primarily white, working-class parish located on a south side neighborhood, similar to the one where he grew up. Grappi's parish responsibilities at St. Veronica, which included the religious education of high school students, did not afford opportunities to address racial inequality directly, with one significant exception. During his tenure as an associate pastor, housing authorities announced that they were considering constructing low-income public housing units in the area. When a group of St. Veronica parishioners gathered to discuss the proposal and to consider a response, it became evident that their primary fear was an influx of African Americans. Grappi, outraged by the blatant displays of racism he witnessed, rebuked the group. For the next 10 Sundays, the young priest preached against racism from the pulpit in what might best be described as a one-man protest. Grappi's actions strained relations with some adult members of the congregation, but also gained the admiration of many students who later joined him in the YC in their many protests. Finally, in 1963, the Chancery granted Grappi's wish and transferred him to St. Boniface Church in Milwaukee's inner core. St. Boniface proved to be a supportive place for Father Grappi's growing interest in racial justice. In addition to carrying out his duties as priest, the pastor, Father Eugene Blydorn, was a sociologist and also worked as a high school social studies teacher. He had been greatly influenced by the Carthaginian movement and ran the Carthaginian Center in Milwaukee for a stint during the 1950s. Like Gottschalk, Blydorn understood the struggles of local African Americans and sought out ways to help. Throughout his tenure as pastor, Blydorn supported Grappi's involvement in civil rights activism from the pulpit to the press. The other young associate pastor at St. Boniface, Father Michael Neuberger, shared Grappi's commitment to young people through a series of youth activities at the church. These programs, along with the church's school and its close proximity to North Division High School, the city's largest African-American high school, afforded Grappi the opportunity to continue cultivating close relationships with many black children in the neighborhood. Later, Pat Flood also joined the staff at St. Boniface. It is not surprising, then, that St. Boniface became the primary movement center in Milwaukee during the open housing campaign. As important as these local factors were in the civil rights development of Father Grappi, as these local factors were in the civil rights development of Father Grappi, a series of southern excursions between 1961 and 1965 had perhaps the most profound impact on him. On April 2, 1961, in the wake of the student sit-in movement and the freedom rights, Father Matthew and Father Austin Schlafer, both at St. Francis, gathered Grappi and another young priest, Father Robert Hoffman of St. Sebastian, and headed south. Over the next 2 weeks, the group visited 31 Negro missions in 10 states, making 13 stops in Mississippi alone. Schlafer received official sanction for this sociological tour because he argued that it would help inner core clergymen to better understand the cultural roots of Milwaukee's black migrants. Spurred by the rational inquiry of the head, the trip struck the four clergymen in the heart. At Selma, they talked about economic slavery with sharecroppers, and in Montgomery, they visited a segregated hospital. A New Orleans priest told him about a young African-American football player who died from an injury after being denied care at two white hospitals. Whereas in Yazoo, Mississippi, they learned that local white residents preferred to burn their old clothes rather than donate them to poor African-Americans. And with that, we are just about out of time. Please tune in next week for the continuation of this reading, and have a good night.